Welcome back to another episode of Sound 101. I'm Andrew from DD Microphones, and with me is Mustache Steve.
Trying it on for size.
I'm digging it. This is our first mailbag of the year. This is our first episode of 2020. Can you believe it? We're here.
I can't believe it.
Yeah, well, I can't believe the... Oh, boy. It's mailbag time. This is the part where you guys ask all those questions down in the comments below in all of our YouTube videos. We like to collect those comments, those questions, those little nuggets, and then we challenge each other to some tough questions. And first up, I've got a question for you, Steve. Are you ready?
I'm ready. Let's do it.
This one is from Victor. And because Victor, you are the first question of this episode, you win a V-Love.
Congrats,
so,
Victor.
Victor, down in the comments section, make sure you have your email address listed on your profile. And that goes for almost everyone out there who's watching our channel. Here's the first question from Victor. How do you enhance interview audio coming from a lavalier in post? I'm using an ALAV with Premiere Pro and Adobe Audition.
Okay, well, the good news is that those are two incredibly powerful pieces of software, and it's pretty much all you're gonna need to get really good quality audio from here. I think a good way to think about audio post is there should be two steps. The first step is sort of correctional, and then the second step is enhancing.
Okay.
So, for example, a first correctional step might be a low cut filter.
Okay.
In case there's some sort of hum, something you forgot to turn the fridge off. After you get rid of that stuff, then I would say start to use plugins to enhance the sound. So use an EQ to bring out the frequencies that you think are good.
Maybe a little bit of the highs, just add some crisp clarity.
Sure. And then we've talked about this before. We do it. It's an intensive click removal pass in Audition. You can use the auto heal tool. So any last little annoyances that you can't get rid of using the automated plugins, really you just click, drag, highlight, and then auto heal in Audition, and you can get rid of most things.
That's wonderful.
Basically, you wanna be removing things that are bad before you start enhancing things that are good.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think about plugin order, that's a good way to think about it. All right, Andrew, you ready? Question number two?
I'm ready.
It comes from Roman Sepranov, who asks, what is the best use scenario of a low cut? And is it best to use the switch on the mic, on your recorder, or do it EQ in post?
Okay, so he's asking three different places where low cut exist. There's one at the mic level, there's one at your recorder, and there's one always in post.
Yes.
Question is, which one's the best?
Sure.
What if I told you the answer is really, really complicated and simple all at the same time?
I would not be surprised.
So it depends on in the mic, and this is where it gets really complicated. If your low cut is before the preamplifier circuit, but after the capsule. So like if it lives between capsule and then you have your PCB board, that's when you do it at the mic level.
And will a user be able to tell this by the physical layout of the microphone? Is there a chance that it's wired around it?
Correct. If you have just a toggle switch, it's wired into the preamp circuit. So it's post preamp. So you've already amplified your signal. If you can insert it, and usually this is your higher end microphones that unscrew capsules, will actually let you add a low cut filter between your capsule and your preamplifier tube. At that point, you are actually attenuating those frequencies before they are amplified altogether. Kind of like what you were saying, you want to do your corrections before you do your enhancements.
Right.
So at that point, if your microphone allows it, that's a great place to do your low cut. If your microphone does not allow it, it doesn't matter, because essentially you've already amplified your circuitry. And in a lot of recorders, the low cut filter is before the gain boost stage. You can check your block diagram for your recorder in your manual. A lot of recorders will put that before the amplification stage.
Mm-hmm.
And in post, you have so much EQ power in post.
Right.
Post is actually like one of the best options.
Sure, and you can A/B it, you can toggle it on and off and listen to it. You can have absolute control over it. If you have it on the mic, you're stuck with your decision. So going back to the first part of the question, what is the best use scenario of a low cut? When would you use this?
There's two philosophies in location sound mixing. One, you don't do any EQ work at all. That is post-production's job, which is why a lot of high-end mics don't feature them.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's the other idea. You do it because you can do some stuff that would help others. And in that case, boom handling noise. A lot of people like to throw on like an 80 hertz low cut or 100 hertz low cut to handle boom handling noise if you have a cheap shock mount. But if you have a nice like Rycote shock mount, like the ones we, you know, use on our boom poles, you don't need that as much because you're not gonna hear the fingers on the boom pole. Well, Steve, I've got now a challenging question for you.
Okay.
I have always heard that you should always put your mono recordings on a mono track in post. But I've also put my dialogue in a stereo track. What is the difference and which one is best?
Okay, this is an interesting question, and I think it should be helpful for a lot of people to clear this up, because there is a hard and fast rule regarding dialogue and mono, but generally that is that you should be recording it in mono. Once it's recorded, if you want to put your mono recorded dialogue on a stereo track, and in essence duplicating your single mono track to have a left and right of the same signal.
The dual mono.
Dual mono. That's totally acceptable and in some cases encouraged, because it will give you opportunities to help the audio tell your story. If you have a kid who's playing in their room and the mom yells from a different room on the right side of the screen, you can pan that hard right and there's an immersive audio element that helps tell the story.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes you feel more engaged with the story going on screen.
So in that case, it's definitely encouraged to use your dialogue that's been recorded in mono on a stereo track. There may be some problems you run into if you end up doing some sort of a mix down or you're sending your project off to a sound designer or someone else. There could be a little mix up along the way. So maybe you could just put a little note in your document about that.
Absolutely.
But otherwise, I think there's nothing wrong with it.
Very cool. Very simple answer for you guys out there.
All right. Question number four comes from Kevin Boucher. Andrew, how do you record a choir, 5 to 10 people, when there are no choral mics available?
Okay, so let's break down what a choral mic is, because this is a new vocabulary term on the channel I don't think we've used before. And a choral mic is a very fancy name for a hardioid lavalier. And what the little added bonus is someone's taking like a fancy paper clip and wound it around a couple of times to angle the lavalier at a slight diagonal, so it's more directional. That's a choral mic. They're not actually anything special. You don't have to worry about like, oh, I've got to go buy a special microphone for this, because at the end of the day, it's just a cardioid pickup pattern. And if you need a cardioid pickup pattern, there's a lot of options on the market, and those other options are going to have bigger diaphragms anyway.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's a bonus. And at the end of the day, what I would do if I've got 5 or 10 people is I'd do an XY pattern on a choral boom, which is the really, really big booms that you'll see like the stand in like a big like 10-foot, 12-foot arm, but without blocking the audience's view of the choir.
Maybe that should be our next challenge.
Ooh, we have to find a choir in Los Angeles.
But what if you are on a budget? What's the simplest way to do this?
I think the simplest way would actually be to put them in a half semicircle. The idea is there's probably an audience watching the choir. You don't want to block the audience's view of the people performing. So I would use a low stand and I would do an XY pattern there, but just under boom it.
And you'd also probably get the more common audio perspective of the audience watching it from below.
Absolutely. I don't know if the live venue audience would notice the difference, but your video audience probably would. Yeah, good point. Well, that wraps up another episode of Mailbag. If you want your questions answered, though, you got to leave them in the comment section below, because that's the only way we're going to answer them. And you know what, honestly, the best part is about leaving those comments below, Steve?
What's that?
They could potentially win a VLOV if they're the very first really good question that we just fall in love with. And we just go, you know what, that one? That's the one that wins the VLOV. And if you want to like watch the show on a regular basis, you got to hit the subscribe button. You got to hit that bell for notifications. But you could also just check us out on all the social media platforms out there. We're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, we're on Instagram. And of course, we are right here on YouTube. He is Deity Steve. I'm Andrew from Deity Microphones. Thank you for watching.
Thank you.